One, we're live. What's up? Hello and welcome to another thrilling edition of the one, the only Schtick Live at Annoyance. Yeah. I am here. I'm Seth Payne. I'm going to be your host for tonight. We're doing stand-up comedy via Zoom / Twitch. It's all sorts of weird, and we're embracing it. We're doing it. It's fun, and I'm so excited for this lineup tonight. Some really good friends. Haven't seen some of these guys in a while. Some of these people for the first time. So it's all over the place. You guys are in for a treat. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for supporting Annoyance Theatre. We're already off to a great start for this. But thank you for supporting Annoyance Theatre. It's about to reopen again. They did a town hall last night. If you haven't watched it, it's on YouTube. It's on Facebook. Check it out. Very excited. My favorite personal part of that that quorum, that town hall, was when they kept asking Mick what they could do to help with the theater. It's kind of like an ongoing bit. And I think towards the end, Mick said that you could make puppets that no one gives a fuck about. And I thought that was, really well done. Miss Mick. So soon, we'll be hanging soon. In the meantime, we're going to do comedy from our bedrooms, baby. Oh, yeah. let's get into it, guys. I recently went and performed at a festival. Whoa, like last weekend, at a festival, and it was outdoors, in Sullivan, Wisconsin. It's an EDM festival, Midwest Player Fest. And, it was low attendance, which actually I kind of preferred that. But it was nice to hear music again. And, I did stand up, for each day, 15 minutes, at noon each day at this festival. It was ridiculous. I realized by the last day I had run out of material. I really only have like 30 minutes maybe of good material. So the last day was weird. And I basically just told a bunch of drug stories. So guess what I'm telling tonight, guys? I knew this drug story. I'm going to see if it works. It really worked for them, but that was day three. And I'm pretty sure everyone was on drugs. So we'll see if it holds up. Let's talk about ketamine, guys. Let's kick it off, dude. First and only time I've ever done ketamine. It's not my drug of choice. But I was at a party and with some ravers in DC, house party, and I was doing a little bit and I just felt weird. And I was like, am I just supposed to feel weird? And they're like, I don't know. And then this one guy, Vikas, who apparently had died at one point and came back, he told us. He's this crazy, crazy Indian dude who I love. Sweetest guy. Very strange though. And he basically was like, you should go into the bathroom and turn all the lights off and light a candle and just rail a line of ketamine. Would not suggest this for someone who's never done ketamine before. It's like how you OD probably. But I did it. I was staying there and I was feeling like a complete doofus, you guys, because nothing was happening except for like my nose hurt. And I was like, this is dumb. And then a full grown lynx rubbed up against me. And I was like, oh my God, you guys, I'm seeing my spirit animal. And the lynx was like, who are you? And like, what are you doing here? And I was like, oh my God, dude. I'm like, guide me away. Turns out he has a kid and it was just a onesie. So not a lynx, just a child at a party that should not be there. Cool stuff. Cool times in DC. Let's see. Another time, first time I ever went to a festival, I took a bunch of Molly, ecstasy, if you will, in a car and was really pumped up. I have an old school 2008 Mazda. It is a piece of shit. And it has old school roll up windows. You got to lock the doors. There's no power locks. So it's pumped up. We take the drugs. And then I'm like, all right, here we go. And this is in Toronto, Canada. So I'm out of the country. And we get out of the car and I tell everyone to lock the doors, shut the doors, realize the car is still on with my only set of keys in the car. So I was like, oh no. So I call AAA and they're like, we're coming, but it's going to take a while because you're parked in the middle of like a festival. So they're on their way. I tell my friends to go inside. And then I forget that I took the ecstasy. So by the time these guys get there, I'm just like dancing with my car. And the guys are like, what the fuck, dude? And I was like, yeah, man, I'm going to fuck this car. So I'm a proud father of a mini Mazda now, guys. It's pretty cool. That's another story. Okay, let's do two more. Okay, so I got a buddy who he took too much acid once, and also in Toronto, unrelated festival. He is like about 7 feet tall, very large, like gentle giant, but he's just a big dude, right? And he's got like, a big belly laugh. He loves drugs, and he doesn't know how to take them, so he takes them in excess. And normally I'm there to be like, hey, man, you dropped some acid. You should wait a bit and then see what happens. I wasn't there for this festival, and so he just kept taking acid. And he thought he was the time wizard, as you do. And he left the festival and just was wandering around in a field in Toronto. And I guess 1,000 years had passed. He bypassed time and space. So he got completely naked, got rid of his ID, all that stuff, and was wandering around downtown Toronto trying to make people happy with his time wizard abilities. Wasn't going successful. So he saw a limo and he crawled into it. And unbeknownst to him, it was a limo for people that were in prom, going to prom. And they showed up and there was a giant naked raver guy tripping his balls off in this limo. called the police. It took like 5 cops to get him out of the limo, and he like broke the windows. I didn't even know if that was possible. Then they had to mace him, and he woke up in a hospital bed. And then went to the festival the next day and took more acid, which is pretty cool. My favorite part of that, though, is those prom kids got the best prom experience ever. They got to meet the time wizard, you guys. One time I was in LA, and it was New Year's Eve. I was by myself. I had just moved out there, and I was approached by someone who said, hey, man, where are the drugs? And I was like, oh, dude, the pat down was crazy on the way in here. There's no way there's drugs at this festival. And they're like, no, there's always drugs at a festival. You just look at the person who's having the best time. They probably have drugs. So I tested this theory, and I went up to a guy, and basically he was like, how much money you have? And I was like, $20. And he's like, I can get you very happy for $20. So I was like, okay, cool. So I thought I was going to take Molly. I'd done acid once before and had a bad experience. He takes out a vial, looks like a eye drop vial thing, and he squirts the rest of it into my mouth. A lot of acid, basically. Too much acid, you could say. And I was like, dude, what was that? And he's like, acid, dude. And I'm like, I hate acid. And he's like, oh. And he's like, well, it'll be fine. He's like, you probably won't even feel it. And I was like, okay. He's like, yeah, just forget about it. So I did. And then like weird things were happening. Like I was like teleporting through this festival. And then like 3 hours went by and I'm like, what, where am I? There was a lot of Asian people there because there's just a lot of Asian people in LA. And I kept thinking I was either in hell or heaven. Couldn't tell, but I was like, there's a lot of Asian people in the world. So either way, this makes sense. And then I was supposed to also that night pick up my roommate from the airport at like 1 a.m. So 1 a.m. comes and goes, and I don't know where I am. And finally I pick up my phone and he's like, are you picking me up from the airport? And I'm like, I don't even know like where I am or what's going on. He's like, oh man. So he's like, all right, just find out where you are and I'll take a cab and then we'll find my car. I'm like, okay. And I keep trying to approach people, but I'm like psyching myself out. I'm like, nah, I can't do this. And then at the same time, I'm like, am I talking to myself? Am I making up this entire conversation? He's like, no, this is real. I'm like, I want to go home, please. And I tried to test him by being like, hey, if you're not real and this is made up in my brain, what'd you eat for lunch? He's like, a turkey sandwich. And I'm like, I would totally think of that. I do not believe you. Anyway, I go up to these three guys and I say, like, where in the, like, this time piece, this level, like this physically, where are we? And they tell me and I don't understand it. So I pass the phone. I'm like, I don't know if anybody's on this or not, but if you could tell him. So they tell him and he's like, all right, I'm on my way. So I'm like, okay. And he's like, thank the people. So then I go to thank them. And as I thank them, I realize all three of them are cops. And so I out loud say, oh shit, they're cops. And then I try to run. My legs have melted into the ground at this point. So I just like slowly fell back into this fence. I was like, no, dude. Those cops were cool. They were like, just stay here. You are fucked up. And then we got home. those are my drug stories, guys. I don't know if they were funny. I hope they entertained you. I don't know. We're trying some new stuff. I also write jokes. Come to me in person. I'll do some jokey jokes. All right. You guys ready for your first actual comedian to come to the stage? Yeah? All right. All right. Well, I'm pumped. I hope you are too. I'm so excited to have the one, the only, Erik Totheroh.
Yahoo!
Woo!
Stand by, Erik. Oh no, he's on the phone. I'm gonna get a few dancing.
Oh, good.
No? Yeah, there we go.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Seth, for that groovy intro. I think my favorite part about that story is you, like, very practically thought through heaven and hell. Like, I was like, this is going to be problematic. And then you were like, there's a lot of Asians everywhere. Could be anyone. It was very fun. But yeah, thank you. My name is Erik, and I care about the wrong things I have found in my life. For example, I've gotten fixated on the idea that there is only one perfect article of clothing that has ever existed, and that is a gray Henley, okay? The gray Henley is perfect. It has existed in every time period ever. If you can picture someone from medieval times, right? And they're like working in the field and they're like, oh, it's pretty breathable, isn't it, right? And then like you could jump forward to the Renaissance and then you got like the people in ruffles and they take off the ruffles and underneath, it's a gray Henley, right? And then you go like to these astronauts, they're on a ship, they just like drill the hole in an asteroid or something. I didn't watch the movie, but they take off their suits and it's a gray Henley. It is everywhere. It is perfect. It is versatile. It is the only article of clothing where the number of buttons unbuttoned directly correlates to how much sex you're currently having. Let's go through it. All the way buttoned up, you're like a Kohl's cash daddy. You know what I mean, right? Okay, we get one button, that's a Jurassic Park sexy scientist, okay? You go all the way unbuttoned, you're in the start of a porn film, you're about to have sex on camera. So there's a lot of versatility there, right? Who has the range of a Gray Henley? It is Laura Dern and Gray Henleys and no one else. Exactly. Now, you are probably asking yourself, Erik, why do you care so much about this? I don't know, okay? I don't control my opinions. I always have the strongest opinions about the things that matter the least in life, okay? For example, I think veterinarians are inherently trusted and they haven't earned that, okay? Seriously, think about it. What else do they go by? Vets. That's stolen valor, okay? Secondly, the only way a veterinarian can earn my trust is to do something very simple. And that is to make sure that inside their logo, they include little animals inside their names. And the fact that some of them don't do that, that should be ringing alarm bells for all of us, okay? That is all I'm saying. Like if you can't think through to put like a little dog here in the P or take a little lowercase g and make it a cattail, then I'm just gonna assume that you're the type of person that has to remind yourself not to smile when you euthanize my dog, okay? Okay, I care about the wrong things, okay? I think that the men who murder their wives and children get the good end of the deal by what they are called, okay? Family annihilators, that's rad as hell, okay? Not fair that they get that name. Seriously, okay? Think about it. When I think of family annihilators, I think of like a game show on Nickelodeon where like Kate McKinnon's being a goof and she like lets a little kid pie their mom in the face, right? It should not be the name for a man who kills his family because he's like sad about debt. You know, but I see I'm losing you guys. I'm sorry. I'll bring it back to something a little bit more relatable. Okay. So we've all had a hard year, right? So you know what? Let's get a round of applause going. If any of you have had a year similar to mine where you've come out as bisexual, left the church, and are currently going through a divorce. Round of applause. Yeah, okay. That usually plays better with the crowd. Let's go. How about this? How about a round of applause if you've ever had a friend reach out to you recently and tell you that the reason you're gay is because you looked at too much porn?
What?
That one actually happened to me recently. I had a friend sit me down and he said that you watched so much straight porn, it made you desensitized and led to same-sex attraction. Which is sad and problematic, and it sucked. But also, what kind of videos was he watching? And why have I not seen those videos? Literally, that seems like exactly the kind of videos I would have been searching for the last 10 years. So like, hook a brother up, you know what I'm saying? But yes, I did recently come out. I came out in November, and it was hard. It was hard because of, like, you know, the circumstances that I was in. But I also think there's like an extra layer in this process now that we don't talk about. And it is like, how can I make this life transition look good on Instagram? Right? there's not a great way to transition from like married Midwestern evangelical to like sexy single bisexual comedian, right? It just doesn't happen. And if it does, let me know, because I'll tell you what did not work. And that was posting like a sad self-reflective poem about like my journey. And then a week later, trying to post like a little baby thirst trap. did not trick anyone. Did not get a brand deal with MeUndies. And let me tell you, if you guys have any good ways to do that, let me know, because Pride is coming up. It's my first one. And like, I gotta look good. You know what I'm saying? but anyway, the thing with coming out that a lot of people told me was that a lot of times you go through like a second adolescence, like a delayed adolescence. You get to experience things you didn't the first time around. So I took that to heart, which is why currently I'm living in a dorm. currently why my only mode of transportation right now is a bicycle. And also why I might have to get a summer job to help me pay for all the fun things I want to do this summer. just really living it up. Turns out that when they were talking about delayed adolescence, they meant it metaphorically. And they were mostly talking about sex stuff. So egg on my face. But also, if any of you are trying to hang out later, let me know. And I'll put a little sock on my door and let my roommate know that he's sleeping on the bottom bunk tonight, baby. Woo! All right, that's my time, guys. Thank you so much.
Yeah! Keep it going for Erik, everybody. Oh, yeah. Mm-mm-mm. Oh, man. So good to see you again, Erik. Congrats on the dorm life, bro. We'll do some keg parties.
That's right, kegger.
Little known fact, Rick James is from Buffalo, New York. I'm also from Buffalo, New York. He's buried there. You can go to his gravesite. It's next to a super creek.
That's your friend. Oh, no, I never knew that.
It's super creaking. Yow. Okay. I had some jokes. I have a couple of jokes. Okay. It's not all jokes. You guys, I'm so excited to have this next comedic. Sorry, I'm also doing two things at once. Now, this next comedic god up to the stage. Yeah. Bow before greatness at the one, the only. Aubree Thelen. All right.
Dang, what an intro. Setting me up for failure, but that's okay. It's, you know, it's been a long day. I already had so many things happen. So if you know, like I bomb now, it's just like extra on top of like, going to a doctor's appointment, getting the tetanus vaccine like I'm a 12-year-old or a college student like Erik is living right now. So, you know, it's been a long day. It's been a long 14 months. it's been really hard. And I know that some people are like, but I don't want to hear about the pandemic anymore. I want a hot girl summer. And that's where we're headed. And honestly, I'm not ready for it, okay? I'm not ready. I'm not ready physically. I'm not ready emotionally in any way, shape, or form. Like psychologically, one of my friends texted me about one of her recent lowest points where she was sitting in her car taking a virtual therapy appointment. So her car, not even like her office. And this was this week. And I was like, we're not there yet. We're not here for hot girl summer. Although I'll say, everybody that's into hot girl summer, I want you to have the hottest, the wettest, the girliest that has ever existed. Okay. I'm not shaming you. That's to you, Erik. Go ahead. Have that hot girl summer. Okay? But I am saying that I'm not emotionally ready for it. I would rather be like probably the Victorian ghost that lives in my apartment and watch me cry while I ate day old pizza this last year weekly. That's probably where I'm at. Okay. So I have a different proposition for everybody. And I know at first you're going to say, Aubree, that is unhinged. That doesn't make any sense, but I'm going to tell you why. Okay. I logged on to Instagram this morning trying to find out what my hot girl summer could transform into. And one of my friends is on a trip to Alaska. Her boyfriend's a ship captain and she was watching whales. And you know what I thought when she had this beautiful killer whale jump out of the water? I thought to myself, this is my orca girl summer. And let me give you the reasons why, okay? This doesn't come out of nowhere. It's perfect. I don't want to be perceived anymore. That is what I learned from the pandemic. I go to grocery stores the last month. Every single week, I've gotten approached by a man who wants to hit on me or ask me directly on a date. I am not here for this anymore. So I just would prefer to be in the depths of the ocean, hanging out with like maybe a giant squid, another sea animal that no one knows anything about. Like that's what I would like to do. And you know what? I get to choose when I get to be majestic. Like nobody cares about a killer whale until all of a sudden it breaches the water like the most beautiful thing that's ever happened. And people clap on the boats, you know, like that's what I want this summer. I want to be perceived when I want to be perceived. Okay. Also, don't worry. I have more reasons. Okay. So also Free Willy, let's just talk about it. Let's keep it out in the open. Have I seen Blackfish? No. Have I seen Free Willy since I was 6 years old? No. Will I be taking questions about the theory in this context? No. I will, though, however, think back to how I felt when I saw that freedom be gained, that child not be crushed by the whale, and everyone cried. That's what I want my summer to be like. My summer could be like a movie about freedom, okay? And lastly, I want everyone, honestly, very similar to a killer whale, I want them to be afraid of me. I want them to think that I am beautiful and majestic, but at the same time, know that without emotion, if they get too close, I will tear them limb from limb. So that is really, I'm feeling Orca Girl Summer, and you're probably asking yourself, for half of the brain cell that I convinced in every single one of you, why this is a good idea. How can I join, right? Like, you're probably like, but how, Aubree? How do you have an Orca Girl Summer? And I planned it out, don't worry. So first of all, a lot of black and white. Who did it best? Was it Mickey Mouse? Was it Cruella de Vil? Was it, like, Nosferatu? Probably. He did it really well. So I'm just saying, like, it works, okay? The original. Beyond that, probably a lot of sushi. You could be vegetarian and eat sushi if you didn't know. And then also, I would like to just say openly that I think the most important part of Orca Girl Summer, in my opinion, is making sure that you know the call of my people. And you know, this isn't the summer of cultural appropriation, so it's not a spirit animal. That was 2017. That was the summer of cultural appropriation. This is Orca Girl Summer, okay? And so I imagine, I'm not gonna imitate it now because I would shatter your eardrums, but I'm just saying that all those men who approached me in the grocery store this last month, if I had screeched at them like an orca, they would have surely left me alone. So with that, I hope that you all can join me this summer. It's bound to be fun, a lot of pretending to be a mermaid, okay? So that's what I'll call it. I told you this was going to be unhinged, Seth. So. We'll not be taking questions about Free Willy or Black.
Keep it going for Aubree, everybody. Woo! Oh, my God. as someone who avidly watched Free Willy every hour of every day as a young child, I thoroughly enjoyed that. So hell yeah. Give it up. I have a lot of shout outs. I'm also monitoring the Twitch. I have advanced where I can see your comments in the Twitch. Thank you, all the people watching. A lot of people are giving it up for Orca Girl Summer. That is a hashtag that is now trending on Twitch. It is ruining Twitch as we speak. It's awesome. Or maybe it's making it better. Fuck yeah. We're rocking and rolling, guys. This next comic coming up, I remember meeting him through Schtick back in D.C. So excited to have him on here. Are you still in D.C.? Joe?
I live in Annapolis, Maryland, but yeah, I still perform in DC quite a bit.
The DC area, yeah, Maryland. Awesome. That's awesome, yeah. Man. Well, hey, that's where we have people from all over the country joining you for some comedy tonight. So give it up for the one, the only, the hilarious all the way from Maryland, Joe Gagliardi.
Oh, Seth. Woo. Thanks very much. Oh, God. Wow. That's a great intro, man. Guys, please, by all means, sit down. Wow. Jesus, a virtual standing ovation. My God. Oh, man. That's kind of an awkward use of the word virtual, right? I'm so sick of using that word that has crept into everything that we've done over the last 18 months, right? Like a virtual comedy show, that works just fine. Virtual lovemaking with your partner, that's not really the same. It's not the same category. Like, I tried to entice my wife the other night, but I had the wrong Zoom meeting passcode. So no luck there. I did, however, meet a nice gentleman named Henry who very much wants to meet up outside the Applebee's down the road for some reason. Seth, man, I absolutely loved your drug story about Special K that essentially started out, I did Special K and I, quote, started to feel a little weird. Unquote. Nice. Nice. You nailed it. I would agree. That's how I felt. Oh, God. No, but these virtual shows are nice because it gives me, it saves me a ton of time not driving to and from shows, right? Which gives me extra time to fulfill my husbandly duties, which usually involves apologizing for something I didn't know I did, which is frustrating. But these virtual shows are very different, obviously, than live shows, especially for us performers, right? Like, if this was an in-person show, I would absolutely have pants on. But it's usually a requirement. I probably also would have taken a shower at some point in the last week. I'm going to be perfectly honest, right? If you think I'm gross, you know damn well 2020, 2021, the pandemic, that killed the daily shower forever. Okay, so it's going to be a disgusting return to society after when the quarantine is finally all over. But the biggest thing that's different about these virtual shows from a regular comedy show is that, you know, public speaking is one of the greatest, one of the number one biggest fear most people have, right? Doing a live comedy show in front of people is scary. You're on stage, you're vulnerable, there's no place to hide. It's like skydiving, right? It's like a rush, it's scary. But these virtual shows, somebody touched on it earlier, there's not really any state, like the couch I routinely fall asleep in is like right behind me. It's a very comforting environment, you know what I'm saying? so like if a live comedy show is like skydiving, these virtual shows are like you strap on your parachute and you jump out of a parked car. It's like in your own driveway. It's just not, it's not the same. I don't think movies are going to be the same. This pandemic really changed everything. Like, I'm a big fan of zombie movies, apocalypse movies. But from here on out, if those movies don't start with a toilet paper and yeast shortage, dude, I'm out. Like, you got to keep it real, Hollywood. You know what I'm saying? Like, of all the things I would have thought would happen at the apocalypse, I didn't think a yeast shortage would be, but whatever. The pandemic has given me some time to innovate, though, with my comedy, which is great because you can't stop innovating in this game. I took a cue from, I like to watch sports, right? And during the pandemic, it was kind of weird because I would be watching these sporting events and I would see that there's no one in the stands, but I would hear this fake crowd noise, right? And I thought to myself, that's so weird. Like, are the players even into it? They know nobody's watching. They know that noise is fake. Like, you gotta be a real egomaniac to benefit from fake noise. You know what I'm saying?
Ha ha ha.
Sit down, guys. Seats. Thank you for wow. Oh God. Oh, that's a fun one. I like that one. Nice day today, though. I'll leave you guys with this. It's coming up on flip flop weather, which is great. I love me some flip flops. They really are kind of the ultimate sign of success, right? Because when you're wearing flip flops, what you're really saying to the world is, no matter what happens, I will not be running anywhere. So that's pretty good stuff. Thanks so much to Seth for setting this up, man. For you all being here. Really means a lot to me as a comic in 2021, or as I've been known for the past 18 months, a door dasher. I left a six-figure career actually to pursue comedy in my mid-30s because midlife crises are real. You know what I'm saying? I would encourage anybody to follow in my footsteps. You know, you want to chase your dreams. And I can tell you that unequivocally, hoping you can pay your mortgage is a lot more fun than knowing that you can. So I'm Joe Gagliardi, guys. That's been my time. Thanks very much, Seth. Appreciate it, everybody.
Yeah. Stay safe. Keep it going for Joe, everybody. Woo! Woo!
Thanks very much.
Oh, yeah. So good to see Joe again. That's awesome, man. So glad you're crushing it still out there. Hopefully get to see you again in person. I think the Schtick, they're gonna bring it back in DC once things start opening up again, which is soon.
Nice, man. That'd be great.
So, yeah, so hopefully if you're ever in DC, check out a Schtick show. Y'all in Chicago, and then vice versa, because we're gonna be doing it out here. Hopefully doing it at either Annoyance or Shuba's in some iteration. Those are the two top places. It's gonna be rad. We are gonna keep rolling right along. Thank you guys at home. Oh, we're getting so much love. I think somebody said they love Applebee's, which is rad. I love these comments on the Twitch. Keep them coming. They fuel me, and then I pass them along to our comics, which then fuel them. Speaking of fuel, this next guy is going to drive you crazy. Like, all right. Give it up for the funny, the hilarious Jason Sklenar. There we go. Okay.
Wow. Thank you so much, Seth. I really appreciate it. It's a privilege to be here, you know, in my own home, sweating in the same chair I spend 8 hours a day in. It's really an honor. But in like a bit of life news, I did recently turn 26.
Yeah.
He doesn't look a day over 24. Thank you. Thank you so much. For real. Hold the applause. I'm dead serious. I am not on my parents' medical insurance anymore, and I can't get the ringing in my ears checked out anytime soon. So just like no loud noises. I would really appreciate it. But I did use my last like insured week to get my first prescription glasses. Again, hold the applause, but feel free to tell me I'm hot. I really love that. I'm here for all attention. And if my therapist, Ryan, is watching this, I did try on confidence. I didn't feel great about it. Also, these are not billable hours, and this isn't a cry for help so much as a scream. but no, I'm joking. He's not watching. He does not like me. no, but I am 26. I feel old. I understand in the grand scheme of things, like it's not old at all. But to be like 26 and gay means I'm actually an elder in the community. Thank you. If this was Midsommar, I'd be jumping off a cliff in like 2 days. No, but I've been like trying to connect to my, you know, my like youth culture by going on TikTok. I don't know if you guys have heard of that small little indie app. and I love, like, I really do love TikTok because it feels like a really gorgeous space to realize that every single 20-year-old has your ideal body. And to also find out that your last original thought kind of drowned at sea like 5 years ago. So it's just, I will never be posting there. Don't worry about it. Don't follow me. It's not worth it. But I am like, I feel very honored and like love being on TikTok because it introduced me to Olivia Rodrigo, the pop phenom, you guys know her, driver's license, deja vu. And I'm just like so ready for her to absolutely obliterate my 2021 Spotify Wrapped. Like, she is just going to wreck house this year in a way we haven't seen since Charlie XCX released Pop 2. Like, she's just going to top to my chart. And I like don't know why at 26 I'm identifying with a 17-year-old so much, like in her music. It is a little confusing. I do think it's because she reminds me of my high school girlfriend, though, and I see stunned faces everywhere. I had a girlfriend, I know. Never said I was an actor and never said I did it right. I was constantly talking about like playing Zac Efron's abs like a keyboard, you know? Kind of silent knighting my way right onto his dick. I don't think I fooled anyone. But she like, they do really remind me of each other, I guess, Olivia and my high school girlfriend. Because they're both like pretty in a way I can appreciate from a distance. They're like major Swifties. And I do say that with love because some of my nearest and dearest are Swifties. And they both publicly dumped a gay man, which is huge in 2021. I will say, I think the major difference though is that Olivia did not start a group chat with the popular girlies calling me a faggot. So like, she still has time though, if we're being honest. But in my like high school girlfriend's defense, she hit the nail on the head. She was right on about that. correct diagnosis. I do kind of wish she like included me in that group chat though, you know what I mean? She could have saved me years of therapy and wondering why my Instagram explore page looks like a casting call for Marvel's next big Chris. You know, just like constantly scrolling through toned ads and pecs, being like, you guys, the algorithm's crazy. The algorithm's really crazy. Why is this happening? And I will say again, I apologize for using the F slur. Like, I know not everyone's comfortable with that. I am, obviously. Don't want to victimize you all, scandalize you all before Pride. But I do have my credentials in order. Like, I've absolutely dumped out on enough dicks in the great state of Michigan to like hold that word. So I'm just gonna run with it, you know. But yeah, I mean, that's really it. I'm Jason Sklenar. Sorry, that one's not for you guys. Sometimes when I'm anxious, I dissociate, so I'm just looking at the screen like, you are Jason Sklenar. No, but for real, thank you, Seth.
Yay, keep it going for Woo! Jason, everybody.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we're rocking and rolling. Oh my gosh, little known fact or little surprise fact for you, that was Jason's first time doing stand-up ever. The confidence level on it. Oh my gosh, round of applause for Jason. That was awesome. Let's see, in the chat some people said shout out to Ryan Glasses King. I'm super cis and you're hot. Swifties, oh my God, in the house. Lot of love for you, Jason. I love it. Oh my gosh, we're gonna keep this party going. I think I kind of like doing like the punny introduction. So you guys ready for another bad punny introduction? It's Woo! The Windy City, and this next comic is gonna blow you away. Oh my God, it's Paula Harrington, everybody.
Hello. Hello. I'm Paula. Hi. How's everyone doing? Is everyone okay? Good. Good.
Yeah.
I'm fine. I realized today that I am about halfway done being 24. So I have about 6 months left of being fuckable. And that's very humbling for me. I'm sorry you've crossed that bridge, Jason. I'm so sorry.
Thank you.
I actually had a premonition when I was 22 that 24 was going to be a very big year for me in some way. And so far, I have consumed 3 different documentaries and an audiobook about Princess Diana. So, I mean, I was right. It's been a happy year. But really though, this year has actually been good for me in like one way. I've been taking like really good steps in raising my self-esteem. I grew up with a perpetually low self-esteem, which I told that to someone yesterday and they were like, really? You? And I was like, yes! I know. In a fair world, only the Uggos would have bad self-esteem, but it's not a fair world. It's not. It's unfair. I think a reason why my self-esteem has been on the incline is because I started posting uncensored nudes on my Twitter. Oatmeal and Jif. It's oatmeal and Jif. And I don't know if it's, you know, I started out doing it, like, I didn't know if I was seeking, like, validation or body positivity or validation. But it's really been... It's really been fun so far. Something I didn't expect from it is that I would gain a small group of simps over in Turkey. they have sent me so many nice messages that I can now look at a sentence in Turkish and confidently say that, yep, that's Turkish. so that's been pretty fun. I also know that, like, if I was to fly, like, if I was to take a red eye over to Istanbul right now, like, I would have a guest room. I mean, I'd have to like suck a dick for the guest room, but I have a guest room. It'd be fine. It'd be okay. Another thing is that a fan I didn't expect of my nudes is my mother. I do send her most of my nudes. Kathy's a great open-minded lady and she'll say things like, oh, that's tasteful. That's artistic. And I'm like, Mom, that's my hole. And it's just, you know, it's just so nice. She's very supportive. I would just like to say that at around this time, 10 years ago, I was deep into my 30th re-listening of the Born This Way album. I was in middle school, and for some reason, I heavily identified between the love triangle that was set up in the song Judas. At the same time as this, I had a framed picture of Shakira on my dresser. And just a couple years before that, I went through a phase where I wouldn't stop singing Welsh opera for some reason, and I had my family record it. I lay all this out for you because when I came out as trans to my parents, they both said, we had no idea you were queer. And I'm like, what? My ears are pierced and I'm majoring in theater. What? No, now they're very supportive and loving. I mean, they always were, but, you know, especially like my father, you know, he'll say things like, he's from Boston. I have no idea what the fuck he's saying, but it's very supportive. I feel the love. Today, this is kind of off the cuff. Today, I spent a good hour and a half getting electrolysis in my nether regions, which if you have not done, it is like being attacked by 1,000 insults from your worst enemies, but straight at your balls. And but one day I'll have a grade A vagina. It will be great. It'll be perfect. Okay. Thank you so much.
That's it. Yeah, we got the call, everybody. Oh yeah. Yeah. That's so much fun. So good to see you again. I can't wait to see all you guys in person again soon. It's gonna be hilarious. Actually, it's pretty cool. This show is pretty I didn't really realize it till like seeing everybody here, but I met Paula and Eric and Jen over at Annoyance. And then I met Aubree and Eric over at Conservatory at Second City, and everybody else I've like connected in other comedy ways, obviously. But it's just really cool seeing everybody in the same place, and we're all gonna hang out again soon and enjoy each other's company. It's gonna be rad. Oh my gosh, we got another new shticker to the group. Give it up for the very funny and always on time, Thomas Toles. Woo!
Oh yes, punctual. I love that characterization. Thank you so much. Unlike Paula, I am an Uggo with absolutely undeserved confidence. I just want to say that shortly before the pandemic, I moved to Chicago from Canada to pursue comedy. So I gave up my access to insulin to be here. Sort of brings down the mood. I just want you to know that I have a pre-existing condition known as a liberal arts degree. It is hereditary. My dad and mom both have one. So the only healthcare I qualify for is your approval. If I get dizzy, I just need you to applaud and tell me you believe in me. It's the same healthcare that Tinkerbell has. And though I lack a primary doctor, unlike my Canadian friends, I am fully vaccinated. Yes, give it up, give it up. America's history of monstrous selfishness has paid off for me. So that is good. And now that I'm vaccinated, I finally feel safe doing stand-up over the internet. I will say my apartment is a 2-drink minimum. Glug, glug, glug. So you can see how we're going to have fun here. Now, I will admit the vaccine wasn't amazing. The second shot left me feeling achy and exhausted. I was staring off into space, which is still somewhat better than how I usually feel. So the improvements are already noticeable. And I can get back to what I like to do, my favorite activity, which is getting shit-faced with my boys and watching A24 films in total silence. Minari is so much better drunk, you guys. It just helps you appreciate the triumph of the human spirit. It's really a beautiful movie. I did learn a lot about myself during the pandemic. Like, I thought that I really cared about politics, and it turned out I was just full of directionless rage. Like, I was just so, so angry. Like, I thought that I wanted to overthrow capitalism, but really I just wanted an excuse to yell at my dad. And, you know, he is here tonight. So I do want us to, you know, be nice to him, because no amount of childhood trauma can make up for the fact that I asked a 72-year-old man to create a Twitch account. That is a horrible thing to require anyone to do, but especially him. I do find it funny. I feel like comedians are, they're always kind of on about the same stuff, no matter what is going on in the world. And so people are still complaining about cancel culture somehow. No one has seen their loved ones for 18 months. I think that's stupid. I do think most anti-cancel culture comedians are just jealous that they haven't been canceled yet. They're like, I've been saying fucked up stuff for years, and it would be nice if somebody noticed. Like, it is a cry for help. And I mean, most of us, most comedians are probably not very good people, but we're not successful either. So nobody gives a shit. I am an asshole. And I know why, and I will prove it. If somebody sends me a haiku, the first thing that I do is not read it and appreciate the poetry. I count the syllables. Does anyone else do that shit? Yeah, I bet all of you fuckers count the syllables. We don't really care about Eric's beautiful little poem about his sadness. We just want to point out if he made a mistake, right? That's what haikus are all about. And we do it in a nice way, like, I'm so sorry, but the middle line did have 8. It's just every time, it's incredibly passive aggressive. I do want to say that I found help in some unlikely places. There have been some dark times during the pandemic, but I heard a quote that really resonated with me. And it sounded like this. It was, something went wrong, but don't fret. It is not your fault. Let's try again. That's pretty nice, right? It's simple. It's not your fault. Let's try again. And it wasn't from some hoity-toity therapist or an old book of philosophy. Seth, could you pull up that image now? Yes, this was an error message I received on Twitter, and it did make me cry. Sometimes help comes from unlikely places, and it was so nice that the Twitter Corporation had my... I think I muted myself. You can stop sharing. I'm back. Am I back? Great. You're technology rules. That's okay. Cool. Yes. Yeah, so I haven't had much to do during quarantine, which means I've been watching a lot of porn. That's why I'm doing stand-up. It's the art form that feels the most like masturbating to do. But when you spend too much time watching porn, at least I find that I start to overthink it. And I do think that it can give us a pretty good representation and reflection of the world we currently live in, the social fabric. Like, it's hard to observe all of these step family incest porn videos. It's the most popular subgenre right now, and not think that a lot of these kids come from broken homes. And it's no wonder that they're so desperate for affection, right? I mean, maybe Johnny Sins doesn't need another round of Never Have I Ever with his sister. He needs a role model, you guys. I mean, we went from two girls, one cup to one child, two Christmases. And I think that that is a reason for heartbreak. I also will say that it's not just social conditions of these videos that worry me. There's a series in particular that has struck me called Fake Taxi. Has anyone watched Fake Taxi? I do feel that I've lost even the very kind comedians who are laughing along with this porn bit. So I'm going to try to rally the troops here with Fake Taxi, a beloved genre that everyone surely knows. So it's a series of videos where girls become porn stars so that they don't have to pay cab fare, which, like, compared to other fake agent videos, it's like an incredibly bad deal. It's like $32. But what's fucked up is that Fake Taxi is being undercut by Fake Uber. It is completely destroying the industry. So girls have to get into Fake Uber pool and watch two other people get fucked before they get a turn. It's just disappointing, you guys. I don't love it. I'm going to finish with a pun, because I feel like that is crowd-pleasing and will connect with everyone. So I used to think that sharing Chinese food dishes in a restaurant was too cumbersome, but now the tables have turned, like a lazy Susan. I'm ashamed of saying that, but I will say that I'm more ashamed of the fact that I Googled it when I came up with it, because I thought it was so clever that it must already be famous. Thank you everyone for tuning in. I am Thomas. Have a great night.
Oh yeah, keep it going for Thomas, everybody. Oh yeah, it's the movie from the 90s. I'm dancing to ska. Hell yeah, we're having fun. Fake Taxi, good shout out. I really like the what's the one? I think it's Fake Hostel, where they keep getting trapped underneath the bed. Yeah, that was a weird one. I was like, this is a pretty funny premise, but it's business time, guys. So okay, made it work. Okay, we're moving on. Let's see. You guys want another pun intro? How are we feeling about pun intros? I think they're going pretty good.
Of course,
pretty bad. I love them. You guys, this next comic. It should be orange soda because he's gonna crush it. Okay, all right, they're all bad. Give it up for the very funny and always super friendly Erik Martin with a K.
Oh yes. Yes, I'm very Fanta. Yeah,
nice.
I am Erik Martin. That is a picture of a llama with glasses to my left. And I recently got engaged.
Yeah.
Yes. And of course, everybody's favorite part of engaging is getting the ring. Yay. All my money going away. And but I went with my girlfriend now, my fiance, we went to a jeweler, and it was like, okay, we're just going to go in, ask some questions, like, and then kind of like get out, right? Like, yeah, we're just going to do that. And of course we go in, we're getting ready to ask some questions. And then the saleswoman's like, hey, look at all of our rings. And she's like, oh my goodness. Well, I guess I could try on a few of them. Yeah, that'd be nice. You know, she just starts putting on, oh, rose gold. Oh, oval cut. I never would have thought of that one before. Ooh, and then we get to the pièce de résistance.
The hearts on fire diamond rings. The diamonds that if you look through a magnifying glass on behind them are cut into little hearts all around them to make them shine brighter than any diamonds in existence, so they claim. And I'm immediately thinking, oh shit. she's like, oh yeah, I'm gonna try on that one. Okay, sure, you know, she puts it on and she looks at it and goes, Oh my God. And I look at the price tag and I go, oh my God. she's like, my goodness, it's so gorgeous. I thought it was like a square diamond, but it's actually a round diamond with tiny diamonds around it. And I'm like, yeah, isn't that fantastic? And so she's like, oh, well, thanks for letting me try it on. And I'm like thinking, yeah, great. I got to figure out how to get that. Because that's the ring. When she goes, oh my God, and doesn't say anything else, you know that's the ring. I mean, it was like, oh my God. Oh. And you see the light shining down and the blinking. And yeah, it's the one to get. So we leave and we're kind of talking about it. We're trying to think like, well, maybe there's some other stuff we can go to. And I'm like, I know that's the one though. And we got it. So we go back to try it on again, just to see what we could maybe figure out in terms of getting it. And she goes and tries on some other ones, but we go to try on that one and the ring is gone. And I'm freaking out in my head because it's like, no, that can't be gone because that's the ring. And I'm just thinking some guy came in with his girlfriend and was like, and saw how she reacted. And he's like, here's all of my money. I'm going to get laid now, you know. And I'm just sitting there like, oh, crap. And then it turned out they didn't sell the ring. They sent it back to their warehouse. They'll have it back in the next week. Good. Great. Fantastic. She goes and tries on some other rings. They look kind of nice, but it's not the ring. I know it's not the ring. So we come back in another week. And she goes on and is trying on some other rings. She puts one on and she's like, oh, well, you know, this one's nice. It's actually kind of growing on me. I'm like, yeah. Where's the ring? They bring it out and put it on. And again, she's like, oh, my God. And I'm thinking, yep, that's the one, that's the one. And she goes, oh my God. But you know, this one's really growing on me. I know which ring to get. And it's growing on you. Yeah, fine. Yeah, it's got that nice, but this is the ring, this is the one. We come back and we finally are talking to them, trying to figure out all of this stuff. And I finally go, yes, that's the one we're getting. That's the one. We figured it out and got it.
Woo!
Yes. Success. But it hasn't, you know, it's been good. I'm happy it worked out. I did it. I figured it out. Thank you, Seth, for having me.
Keep it going night, for everybody. Eric, everybody. There we go. There we go. Okay. Cool. Congratulations, Eric. And I'm glad that you used your new fiance as a prop for your bit. Oh my God. Ridiculous. No, I'm just kidding. We're in for quite the surprise because we have one final comic and guess who it is? Drum roll, please. No. It's the, oh wait, do you wanna, oh man, I wanted to do a goofy thing for you, especially because you, man, you're really gonna get thrown through the ringer for this next one. The one, the only, Jennifer Turner. Woo!
That's me. Hello. That was good. I like that one. I really tried to regard. Yes, I'm Jennifer, and I am a flight attendant, And that's my job. And I really love it. And I've come to realize that there is quite a fetish around flight attendants still. That was like established in the 60s and 70s. And people still have this great expectation of this level of sexiness, you know, that the thigh high fishnets, little scarf around the neck, the tight little dress, the little hat. And I mean, if that's what you're into, I'm just about to destroy that fantasy for you right now, because instead of all that, it's more like compression pantyhose, Dansko orthopedic shoes, and Spanx. You know, instead of the little hat, it's the matted, sweaty hair marinated in pretzel dust, eating as fast as you can over a trash can in the back galley, a manicure, in lieu of a manicure, it's Cheeto encrusted fingernail beds, because that's the only thing they had at the airport, okay? And so there's just like a lot to live up to. And first of all, the Mile High Club, that is 5,280 feet. And folks, that's like under final descent. That's way too close to the ground. That's just very dangerous. The landing gear is coming down. That's much more impressive equipment than anything that could be thrown out in the lavatory. And let me tell you that the water on the floor, it's not water. It's just not. So that like, I just abandoned that idea years ago. I've been flying for 10 years and it's okay because what I lack in the sexy flight attendant standards, I gain in the knowledge. You know, we really do know what we were doing as far as like knowing how to evacuate an aircraft and knowing how to save people if they're in trouble on the airplane. Like, we really know what we're doing. And I really wish that people would ask us questions about those things. But the question that people ask us are things like, I mean, in flight, they ask us, have we stopped? Why have we stopped? This is true. Why have we stopped? And I have to sit there and go, ma'am, I guarantee you we haven't stopped. I promise we're moving at a ground speed of about 500,000, you know, miles and miles an hour. We're going very fast. I know, but the little house down there, it hasn't been moving very fast out the window. No, ma'am, I promise we are moving so fast right now. Another one is, will you roll the windows down because I don't want my hair to get messed up? Also a true story. And here's the thing, I'm not judging, but because these are the people that like give me a job. That's the reason I have a job, because of people like that. And you don't know where they're coming from. You don't know their background. It's an unfamiliar environment. And you know, it is our job to be nice to them and keep them comfortable and safe. And that's, you know, that's definitely okay. I'm really do love the job. It's really wonderful. I definitely can't, you know, live up to that sexy standard of the scarf and all that. That's okay. I'm really okay with that. The one tool that I have found, it does work, like aside from the knowledge that I've gained through the training and you know, I have a certificate in mediation and civil mediation that really helps. We learn verbal judo, we learn self-defense, but like the one thing that helps me, the number one useful tool as a flight attendant is the Texas twang. And I lived in Texas for over a decade, so I feel like I have that ownership, like I own it, I can bring it out. So it really does help when I'm in the middle of a delay. So instead of it's ladies and gentlemen,
I'm so sorry. We're 3 hours delayed. If you could please gather your belongings and deplane and gather your things and speak with a customer service representative, they will be able to help you. It works much better when you bring out, honey, baby. Oh my God. Okay. honey, you know, this happens. We have a delay. Mother Nature, you know, she's in a mood. She's not cooperating. I'm so sorry, baby. They said there would be days like this, and there are days like this today. And we're going to get through it. You're going to go to Pete's Fish Bar and get yourself a beer and read that book that you've been wanting to read out in the terminal, and it's going to be okay. Just grab your stuff, baby. Honey, baby, do you know where you are? Because there's a tornado out there, and we're going to be in a tin can in the sky. All right? So you got to count your blessings where you have them. So that's just definitely a much better tool than anything else I have learned in flight attendant training. So that's all I got. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, altar in your white dress. Oh yeah, you guys. We have reached the end of the show. Oh my gosh. Round of applause for everybody who came out tonight. Thank you guys so much for supporting comedy. I'm going to pop this guy up here. Yeah. If you guys enjoyed the show tonight, which it looks like a bunch of you did, thank you for all the comments. During the last one, someone said Texas represent. So hell yeah, they were eating it up, Jen. And also Paula, they were trying to find you, but is it Oatmeal and Jif? Is that
oatmeal underscore and underscore Jif.
There we go. Okay.
Oh yeah,
that's where you can go for the nudes. And I'm sure a lot of other witty, hilarious content. But for now, if you guys really enjoyed the show, right here, donate to the Annoyance. All you gotta do is go to the website and there you scroll down a little bit. There's a picture of Mick and it says, please donate. They need all the help that they can get. They've been paying like full rent apparently the past 3 months, which is crazy because they're not getting any money in. So the donations from you guys help to keep that place alive so we can go and party there and see good comedy in person, see all these guys perform in person and turn up and dance our faces off and drink a bunch and be jolly. Okay, that's been our show. Thank you guys so much. Get home safe. You're already home, but get home safe anyway. And we'll see you guys next month, if not sooner. Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
Have a great night.
Bye.